Robert Lupton and his family moved from the suburbs of Atlanta into the inner city. They felt called to do ministry there. So they sold their suburban home and moved into a neighborhood in downtown Atlanta. They enrolled their kids in the public schools. They shopped at the neighborhood grocery stores. In general, they lived as neighbors among some of Atlanta's poorest residents. They drove a 1977 Datsun that fit right in. But when the odometer on that Datsun rolled to 150,000 miles and smoke started billowing out of the tailpipe, Bob and his wife knew it was time to start thinking and praying about replacing that old car. A friend of theirs who admired what they were doing in Atlanta a few months later heard about their need for a new car and presented them with the keys to a late model, shiny, black Audi 5000 turbo diesel. It was a nice car for the time. It had leather seats that felt good to sit in and were supportive, the kind where you can adjust the back in three different places. It had an amazing sound system that just wrapped them in their favorite kind of music. It was a nice car. It felt like a gift from God and an answer to prayer. So when I look out at you all this Easter Sunday, I'm reminded a little of that shiny late model Audi 5000 turbo diesel. A preacher loves full pews, and there's no better day for full pews than Easter Sunday when families are united in worship and fellowship. And you all look fantastic, just like the children in your Easter best. New neckties and dresses, Easter bonnets. I love seeing you this morning. And the church looks fantastic too. And oh, that music. I love the fancy Easter music. And even the kids, their bellies filled with chocolate and pancakes and jelly beans, they're revved up like a turbo diesel engine. This is what Easter is all about. Or is it? A few weeks after they got that new Audi, a reporter visited Bob and his ministry in Atlanta. And as they drove through the neighborhood and passed Bob's home, he began to feel a little uneasy about this car in his driveway. Would the reporter think that Bob was getting rich off of the people that he was supposed to be serving? Family debated about what to do. The Audi was a gift. Why should they let other people's uninformed judgments decide how they live their lives? People are always going to have something to say, right? And the Audi is a good car. It's reliable. It's the right size for their family. To sell it and buy something simpler would be a pretense of its own. But Bob began to hear a voice in his head, a familiar voice, the voice of his father, who had long since passed away. He remembered how his father would tell him as a child, avoid even the appearance of evil. Avoid even the appearance of evil. And then when Bob would sit quietly before God, he also felt a gentle nudge. A gentle nudge that reminded him of Jesus' words to lay down the things we value most for the sake of Jesus and for the sake of our brothers and sisters in the faith. So, with a note of gratitude to their friend, the donor, Bob and Peggy made the surprising decision to sell that Audi that they liked so much and to trade it in for a simpler car, one that was more sensitive to the real life struggles of their neighbors and more true to the new life they had found in Christ. If we pay attention to the Easter story as it is told by John, I think we might find it to be just as surprising and even more life-giving than all of our favorite things about the Easter holiday. As much as I love that brass quartet, man, I really love it. In John's Gospel, Easter doesn't sound like horns and trumpets or a well fine-tuned stereo system. For Mary, resurrection comes softly as her name whispered in the breath of the living Lord. With one deeply personal word, Mary, Jesus just dispels all of the forces of death and brings forth life into that cemetery, much the same way he calls his sheep to follow his voice or summons Lazarus out of the tomb. You don't need to hear an angel choir to experience new life in Jesus. Where you have been truly known and loved, there already new life is waiting for you. Jesus wants to know you as you are, without pretense, without your Easter finery, to call you by name, to love you. You don't need to hear the voice of God booming in the accent of James Earl Jones. I wish I could be James Earl Jones. You don't need to hear the voice of God in that accent to follow where Jesus leads. That voice might be as familiar as the voice of your father from childhood, or as that gentle nudging inside of you that calls you to follow, to lay down the things that you value the most. Resurrection surprises us by its gentle whisper. Mary. As much as I love the lilies and the tulips, as much as I like looking at all of you in your Easter finery, your new dresses and pastel neckties, Easter in the Gospel of John is not resplendent. It's not buffed to a shine like a late model Audi or new patent leather shoes. In John's Gospel, the resurrected Jesus isn't radiant. He looks like a gardener. How many of you want to come to church today in your gardening clothes? But that's what the resurrected Jesus looks like, a gardener. Some have imagined that like a gardener, he has dirt under his fingernails. It's the dirt of the grave. In a few Sundays, we will see that the risen Jesus still bears the scars of his suffering. The God of Easter, the God who rises from the grave, the God who brings new life out of death, doesn't come shiny and perfect. And God isn't about making you shiny and spiffy and impressive either. God isn't about making you nice. God is about making you new. And sometimes new is messy. New life doesn't mean perfection. It doesn't mean that the memory of our pain is erased. In our new lives, we may still bear the scars from the wounds that have shaped us. We may arise from the grave with dirt still under our fingernails. New life may look less like a shiny new Audi and more like a humble used Toyota that you can pile full of the things that God has called you to deliver. New life looks less like picture-perfect families and more like an awkward attempt at forgiveness and reconciliation, even when it's not deserved. New life looks like an alcoholic in recovery or a survivor of sexual assault saying, "Me too." New life looks like moving to a new country where you don't speak the language and you don't know the customs and you still feel a little homesick for the land you left behind. If there's anything impressive about following Jesus, it's that you are loved so profoundly by God, that God has just swept you up into God's own story of life and death and life beyond death. And if there's anything impressive about Christians, it's not our Easter finery. It's that we are a people who still have the dirt from our graves under our fingernails, but we can stand and say, "Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah." Resurrection surprises us by its messiness, by its earthiness, by the dirt under its fingernails. Speaking of those words we say on Easter, as much as I love that sure and certain proclamation, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, resurrection doesn't actually mean certainty or scientific proof. John, he writes of Peter and the other disciple who entered the empty tomb. He saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand that he was to rise from the dead. He saw and believed and did not understand. He saw and believed and did not understand. The Lupton family believed that that car was a gift from God, and yet they struggled with its meaning in their life. Mary, when she bore witness to the resurrection, she didn't say, "Christ is risen, he is risen indeed." She didn't write a creed or really even make a statement of faith. She just said, "I have seen the Lord." So if you're hearing this news about a man rising from the grave, and you're thinking, "Wait a minute, I'm not sure about that. What does that mean?" Well, you're in good company with Peter and the other disciple. I could give you some theology books to read about all the ways the church has tried to understand the extraordinary and explain the inexplicable. But Easter's not really about doctrinal statements or rational understanding. Resurrection is not a third-person confession. It's a first-person testimony. "I have seen the Lord." Where have you seen life so generous or mercy so abundant that it just defies culture and reason? Where have you seen hope so fresh and joy so pure that it cannot be explained? Those moments you might think, "Wait a minute, did I just see the Lord?" Resurrection surprises us by its inability to be known without being lived. Finally, as much as I love all of our Easter traditions, the sacred and the secular, resurrection isn't really about holding on to tradition or expectations or even religion, really. When the resurrected Jesus is finally clear to Mary, he doesn't say, "Come with me." He doesn't say, "Build an altar at this place." He doesn't say, "Consecrate a holiday on this day." He doesn't even say, remember what I told you. He says, do not hold on to me. Go and tell. So enjoy your Easter traditions, from egg hunts to pancake breakfast to new dresses and fancy music. I will enjoy the full pews, the flowers on the chancel, the abundant alleluia. But let's not mistake these things that we have come to love and expect. Let's not mistake these things for the surprising news that God is alive and God is on the loose. God is still reaching down into the dirt of this world to bring new life. New life that sounds less like a trumpet and more like this bird's name. New life that looks less like a well-dressed, picture-perfect family and more like a gardener in his working clothes with dirt under her fingernails. New life that is less about having all of the answers than living together with the questions. God is still reaching down into the dirt and the graves and the death places of this world and of your life to bring new life that invites you to let go of all that you have expected and valued, and to experience a love that is totally surprising, totally unexpected, but exactly what you have needed all along. Friends, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed, and God is on the loose. Alleluia.
Amen.
As we stand and sing together,